Welcome to the Touch MBA Admissions Podcast. Do you need help figuring out which schools to apply to or how to get into the world's top MBA programs? Hey, you're not alone. Join thousands of others on this podcast and on our site, touchmba.com, as they seek the admissions edge. And now, here's your host, Darren Joe.
Hey guys, it's your host Darren, and welcome to the show where we interview admissions directors and students from the world's leading business schools to give you the inside scoop on what makes them different and how to get in. This week I had Kelly Wilson from Carnegie Mellon's Tepper School of Business on the show, and we really talk in depth about Tepper's unique analytics and leadership focus, as well as the benefits of attending a smaller program where you get more attention in terms of leadership development programs and career services. So I think you'll get a lot of tips from this one. Here at Touch MBA, we specialize in school selection. So if you need help this fall figuring out which schools fit you best, go head over to touchmba.com and to get some free school selection help. We also have an online admissions course and forum. I think this is a great alternative for those of you who don't want to pay thousands of dollars to admissions consultants to get the same great tips and help. You could check that out at touchmba.com/course. Don't apply in a vacuum. Make sure you're getting lots of eyes on your applications. All right, let's get straight to this week's episode. It's my pleasure to introduce our next guest, Kelly Wilson, who is the Executive Director of Master's Admissions at Carnegie Mellon University's Tepper School of Business. And Kelly has a wealth of admissions experience, not just at Tepper, which she joined in 2012, but also she was an assistant dean and director of admissions at the Georgetown McDonough School of Business and the Pittsburgh Katz Graduate School of Business for many, many years. Kelly got her MBA from George Mason University and her master's of management of information systems from Pittsburgh Katz as well. So I'm just really excited for this conversation and to learn more about Carnegie Mellon Tepper from someone who has done admissions at three top schools in the US. Kelly, welcome to the show and thank you for your time.
It's nice to be here, Darren. Thank you so much for having me and giving me the opportunity to talk to your listeners.
Kelly, I like to get straight into the meat and potatoes, so to speak, of the episode and ask the question, what makes the Tepper MBA unique from other leading business schools in the world?
You know, I love that question, and I like to respond to that question because we get it a lot as admissions officers. I like to respond to that by asking a question back, which is, do you know how to solve a problem that has no precedent? And I'll let that sink in for a minute. It's an important question because what the Tepper MBA provides you is mastery of analytics in the core curriculum. And then as you move into the electives, you begin to apply those skills into the elective classes. And through our analytics, you gain an economic understanding, you learn optimization, predictive and prescriptive modeling, and you're able to respond to uncertain and complex business issues. And so this allows you, as you're thinking about that question, solving a problem that has no precedent, you're equipped with a variety of models that you can assess a business situation and apply these tools so that you can come to a better conclusion, a more informed decision, if you will. You also, through our curriculum, gain a solid understanding of marketing, finance, operations, accounting, and strategy, of course. The other piece that's really important that I want to share is we're not just about analytics. In fact, we have developed a leadership development program here, and it's the combination of leadership and analytics that we believe sets students that graduate from our program apart in the marketplace. The leadership development is actually a part of the core curriculum. Most business schools will offer leadership classes. Some have optional leadership training, but we're one of the only schools committed to developing leadership skills through this required coursework. And I'd be excited to share a little bit more about that with you through the conversation as well.
Yeah, I mean, I'd love to hear more about that, the leadership development program that you guys have.
Sure. So we developed a program in partnership with Development Dimensions International, which is a leading talent management consulting firm. And they have a proprietary assessment tool that's based on behaviors of a manager, of a frontline manager. So it's a 4-hour online assessment across 9 leadership competencies. Once you go through the assessment, you get a personalized report giving you insights into your leadership and management behaviors and skills. And so with these competencies, knowing kind of in this simulation how your strengths kind of shine through and identifies, the report will identify for the student the areas where they may need to focus on, they then have a starting point for the 2 years that they're here at the Tepper School. Our executive director for the Accelerate Leadership Center is Laura Maxwell, and she actually came to us from DDI. She was a leadership consultant there, and so she and her team help our students prepare a plan for the time that they're in school, but also to enact throughout their internship. They have access to one-on-one leadership coaching. And so if you think of it as literally having an executive coach during the 2 years that a candidate is here in school with us, it's a phenomenal learning experience that's literally hands-on and experiential. Our students absolutely love it, and it makes a difference as they move into their post-MBA job and as they begin to move through their career beyond that initial position that they have.
Yeah, and that's related to what I see, at least, as another advantage of the school, which is its size, right? Because it would be tough to run this program, you know, with a really large class of, say, you know, 700 people or 600 people.
That's exactly right, and you hit the nail on the head, Darren, because that is one of the reasons that we can do this. And, you know, you have to imagine the time that it would take for the students to meet with the leadership coaches and to work through their assessment and really understand where their skills fall, and then to go through a series of workshops. The ability to do a lot of that training one-on-one is really important, and we can only do it because we're a smaller program, which is a definite strength. Another thing to mention is our faculty to student ratio is 5-1. And there's a great benefit to having that smaller community, and that's one of them.
If we could talk a little bit more about your focus on analytics and strategy analytics and dealing with problems that have no precedent. I mean, I love that question. How is this manifested in the curriculum? Is it a curriculum thing, or is it outside the class in terms of this focus on analytics?
Great question. The focus on analytics is part of the core requirement. So in year one, in addition to students taking the foundations in business, accounting, finance, marketing, strategy, they're also taking courses that give them these specific analytical skills, like optimization. They will learn these very specific skills using different softwares that will enable them to develop a deep set of skills in analytics. And so then when they're moving into their electives, the faculty that are teaching the electives assume that they've got those skills, and then they begin to apply them throughout the curriculum. So it begins in the core, and that foundation is built in the core, but then is perpetuated throughout the curriculum. When our students go into their internships, they're able to immediately make an impact. You know, oftentimes students from other programs aren't as able to do that right away.
And how would you describe the student culture at Tepper? You've been at 2 other leading business schools. Like, what makes the Tepper student culture unique?
Because it's a small program, it really is a family. And the familial feel is one that not only do I see, but our students talk about. And in fact, when prospective students come to visit, their comments, I would say 99% of the time, I want to say 100, but 99% of the time, had to do with how strong the community is. And I think many schools will talk about the strength of community. There is something different here, and I And again, it's not just because I'm seeing it, but our prospective students give us that feedback all the time. Students here are collaborative. And so if a candidate thinking about business schools would not thrive in that type of environment, this is not the school for them. Team orientation and collaboration is very much part of the fiber of the Tepper School. That familial feel goes beyond just kind of the things that happen here at Tepper in the classroom, and support throughout, you know, looking for jobs and interviewing. On a weekly basis, kind of a social thing, we have a tradition that we call beers, and the students are able to kind of blow off some steam and catch up with one another. And they really are engaged in the experience here. There are over 30 student clubs and organizations that they can take advantage of in terms of exercising the leadership skills that they're learning. And those clubs are both professional and social in nature. And so they're together both inside and outside of the classroom.
Academically, I know that, like for example, U.S. News and World Report has ranked Carnegie Mellon really high for information systems and operations management and supply chain and finance. But I was wondering, are those what you see as the main academic strengths of the school, or what can students really look forward to in terms of the classes they're taking?
There is a breadth of courses that students take here, obviously, and they really do run the gamut of the typical courses that you might think that you can take at a business school. I think one of the really cool things that Tepper offers is that we're part of this larger CMU community, and students can take classes not only in the business school in some of the areas that you mentioned, but also outside of the business school. It's not uncommon to find our students over in another building taking, you know, classes at different schools, whether it's part of a dual degree program or they're just cross-registering because they want a specific skill set. And the way that CMU operates is the boundaries to do that are very low. It's very easy to take advantage of some of the top programs that exist elsewhere within the university. So academically, students really have an opportunity to step back and look at what are the skills I want to develop, what classes fit within that skill development set at Tepper, and then are there some other schools associated with CMU that I might be able to tap into to develop some specific skills?
So students can take 3 or 4 classes outside Tepper?
That's right, they can. They can, and it can be through a defined dual degree or track, but it may be just a one-off class that they want to take because they think that the subject matter is very interesting.
How does the school plan to evolve or change in the near future?
One of the things that you may have heard about beyond our Accelerate Leadership Center as a relatively new innovation is the fact that we're going to be building a new building soon. And so David Tepper graciously gave us a LEED gift of $67 million that initiated the Tepper Quad. And so this is not only important for the Tepper School, but the Tepper Quad is going to be the new gateway for campus. So it's a 4.5-acre section of campus where this new quad is going to be built. Our building is going to be the first building. It's going to redefine campus physically and then in terms of, you know, interactions across campus. So we're really excited about that. Work has begun this summer and we look forward to moving in the fall of 2018, I believe.
It's always nice to have new facilities.
Well, and the exciting thing about the physical construct of the new building is that it's going to include not only the Tepper School in our building, but also it's going to be a center or a hub for a lot of campus-wide activities that are happening around innovation and entrepreneurship. You can imagine collaborative spaces that are dedicated to startup activities occurring at various colleges. This is going to be the center of where all of that happens. It's very exciting and we're looking forward to it very much.
Kelly, why should candidates get their MBA in Pittsburgh, of all places in the US?
Pittsburgh is an amazing city that has undergone a transformation over the last 10 years or so. The success of the region's economy has been largely attributed to education and medical sectors. And so you'll hear it referred to as meds and eds. And the renaissance that's happened here was something that the president gave a nod to as he held talks here a few years ago. And so we're a city that has really come into our own. I'm not trying to brag, but I will give you a couple of snippets of how we're seen from other points. The Washington Post recently named us America's hippest city. We also, National Geographic named Pittsburgh as a must-see place. And that's pretty exciting because we know we love Pittsburgh, but to get that kind of a perception of us from outside of the areas is really kind of cool.
Do the students live on campus or, you know, are there a lot of city activities going on there or is it more of a rural feel to the campus?
So we are located in Oakland, which is just a couple of miles from downtown Pittsburgh. And so we're part of, there is a campus, and so that's a definite part of the experience here, but we're right in the Oakland neighborhood as well. And so our students typically will live in some of the neighboring areas of town. Shadyside and Squirrel Hill are two places that you'll find most of our students living. Both have offered different experiences for students. Shadyside is probably the most popular. It's a great part of town with a lot of activity, a lot of restaurants, shopping. And Pittsburgh actually is has been named by Bon Appetit as America's next food town. So I can't miss talking about the great restaurants that are here as well.
That's great. Yeah, thanks for providing, you know, that context to getting your MBA in Pittsburgh and at CMU. If we could now talk about admissions. So you mentioned that, you know, strategy analytics is a big focus of the program, that you're looking for collaborative students and team-focused sort of applicants. Now, how does that translate into the admissions side? Could you share some of the fit qualities you're looking for from applicants to your school?
Oh, of course. It won't be surprising to understand that we're, you know, looking for driven, smart people who are intrinsically motivated to succeed. I mentioned, you know, the desire and the ability to thrive in a team-oriented environment is really important. We're looking for candidates who are, you know, want to be part of this environment. When students visit, prospective students visit, they tell us it's a little bit different from what they're finding in other schools.
Could you expand on that? Like, what do they tell you?
The idea that students are not a collection of individuals that happen to be, you know, in the same classes, but instead are a group of people who genuinely care about one another and support one another, whether it's, you know, through classes or in a case where a student might need some assistance outside of school. It's something that is visible to people when they visit and they spend time with our students in class and outside of class. It's part of what makes up our student body is genuine kind of caring about one another.
That's fantastic. And as your program really focuses in on the analytics. Are you looking for higher, for example, quant GMAT scores from your applicants or for more examples of, how should I say, a background in the hard skills of business or you know, math background?
Not necessarily. So absolutely successful applicants to our program have demonstrated an aptitude for doing some quantitative coursework. But it absolutely is not the case that students need to come to the program with those skills fully developed. In fact, we consider ourselves in the business of helping students to develop those skills. We have students from liberal arts backgrounds who are very successful in the program, just as we have engineers, you know, who are very successful in the program. So I think the one thing that I would want someone listening to the podcast to walk away with is an understanding that you do not have to be someone who has heavy quant skills already. You just have to have aptitude and motivation, and we'll partner with you to make sure that you learn those skills while you're here.
Could you walk us through the life of an application?
Yeah, and this is part of what, you know, I think once a candidate submits their application, it seems like they're just waiting forever for things to happen. So I'm happy to give them some insights into our process. Once the application is submitted, we have a team of people who work to bring those applications to completion. So they'll make sure that all of the documents that were supposed to be received were received, and that we have all of the components available to the admissions committee. Once those applications are deemed to be quote unquote complete, a reader is assigned to the application. Each of the admissions officers on our team read applications and interview. One of the first steps is they'll take a first read of the application. And as a reader, one of three decisions or recommendations, I should say, is kind of the culmination of that first read. And the recommendation can be an admit decision, a wait list, or a deny. If the initial reader considers the application and wants to recommend the applicant for admission, the file goes to the full admissions committee. And I'll talk about that in a second. If the first reader decides that they would recommend a wait list or deny, that file goes to a second reader. When the second reader reads the file, if they agree with the first reader, then that decision stands. If they disagree or have different views of it, they'll have a discussion, the two readers. And if they can come to an agreement, then the decision that they determine stands. If not, they'll come to me, we have a conversation about it, and we'll decide what the next step is for that applicant or that application. If the first reader recommends admit, then it comes to the full committee, and the person that read the file will present the file to ADCOM for what we call a live read. And that's an opportunity for them to present the information and really advocate on behalf of the candidate to the admissions committee in order to come to a full admit decision. In parallel to that, interview invitations go out within a week of the applications being submitted. So if you, as a prospective student, it might not be apparent initially, but think of the application process and the interview process almost as an assembly line, and things have to happen at certain times. And there's a constraint, right, due to time and resources. And so while we can invite a number of people to interview right away, we aren't able to invite everybody that will be interviewed immediately. So as we go through the process and as we progress through the round, additional waves of interview invites will be sent out. Ultimately, everyone that is admitted will have interviewed prior to that decision being sent out.
Yeah, if you don't mind, I'd love to learn more about your interview process, because I noticed on your site that you conduct behavioral interviews. So could you share some more about how you conduct the interviews and share any tips for applicants on how they can succeed in them?
Sure. So our interviews are conducted in a way that allows us to understand different situations where a candidate has done something, right? So that's the idea behind a behavioral interview. The interview is conducted separate from the application read. So the information that the interviewer has in front of them is the resume. It is not the case that we have read the applications referred to as a blind interview. So based on the resume, we're going to have a conversation with the interviewee. The questions are all based on examples of situations where they've done things. So an example of a question that I like to ask is, give me an example of a time when you were in a leadership role and you were faced with a challenge. How did you approach it, and what was the resolution? So the important thing is not necessarily knowing that's the question I'm going to ask. What the candidate needs to think about is in a situation like that, what kind of example can they provide? Because the meat of the value that I get from that question is in the response that the candidate gives. And when I hear something that they're sharing in their example, I might probe on a particular issue, because we're looking at a variety of competencies that we're assessing candidates on those competencies. And if I hear them talking about something, I may go in maybe a slightly different direction than one might imagine with that question. So the value of that really comes from the answer that the candidate gives. So it's important for candidates, a tip would be to really think about some specific examples that you can dig deeply into. I would caution against taking an example that kind of happened, but then it didn't really work out the way you wanted to. So you may take another example and kind of meld them together, because it becomes clear through the follow-up questions if a candidate is not really talking about a singular event, and we want to make sure that we're digging into their behavior around that one particular event. So spend some time to prepare for the interview by thinking about specific examples of times when you succeeded and you failed, maybe when you were in a leadership role, or just as importantly, when you were a strong team member, and come prepared with those types of answers.
Have you read the book Who?
No, I haven't. Oh, okay. I put that on the list.
Yeah. No, it's a fantastic book about how some of the world's basically billionaire business owners, how they select people to help run their businesses. And a lot of it's based on behavioral interviewing. So yeah, anyways, I think that that's really interesting part of your admissions process. What three things can applicants do to improve their chances of admissions?
One of my soapbox moments is when I'm asked this question. So I'm going to give you an answer, and please feel free to reel me in if you need to. But one of my biggest concerns is when an applicant doesn't take the time to read the application instructions. So the most important thing that a candidate can do is read the application instructions. There are certainly commonalities across MBA programs in terms of what we need you to do to apply to our programs, but there are also important nuances. And so to position yourself to present the most professional application package that you can, you need to have read those application instructions. I would start there, and it seems almost maybe from one perspective a minor thing to bring up. From another perspective, maybe, you know, something that someone's like, of course, why wouldn't you read the application instructions? I believe in it enough that that's where I'll start. So please read the application instructions. Also, to improve your chance of admission is to really understand the school and the program, not just with what's written on the website, but connect with our students. We have on our website in the admission section a searchable database where you as a prospective student can search on different factors and find a student who has opted into a database of folks who are willing to share their experience at Tepper. So the more you know about the experience that our students are part of, the more you'll understand if it's a good fit for you. And so to understand how the skills you'll develop here will benefit you in the long run in terms of your career is also a really good way to be able to write your application so that you're pulling in those important elements of the program that you've internalized in some way and understand how it fits with what you want to do. So the third thing that an applicant to do to improve their chance of admission is to treat the interview like a job interview. It's an important component of the application. We put a great deal of weight on the interview interaction. Think of it in terms of, you know, how you're presenting yourself to us is what we imagine is the way that you'll present yourself to a potential employer. And so it's an important component of the application process. And it's one that I think you have complete control over and you can prepare for and knock it out of the ballpark.
Your interviewers aren't the same people who read that applicant's application, correct?
Yeah. So in terms of how we assign interviewers and application readers, we are trying to ensure that a different person reads your file than interviews you. Right, because those two perspectives are really helpful when we're making the assessment. So at times we can't, you know, we may not be able to avoid the reader and the interviewer being one and the same, but we're not specifically trying to do that.
Thank you so much for those tips. And I have one last admissions question. It's based on one of your essays, actually your first essay, which is when you ask candidates to describe a defining moment in their life and explain how it shaped them as a person. So a very personal question. Can applicants share an example from outside of work? Does it have to be a professionally focused answer?
The answer to the question does not necessarily have to be professional. but I think it needs to be appropriate. So there are examples that each of us can share that really would not be appropriate to share in, you know, in the forum of applying to a professional degree program. And so that's the one caution. It's just the judgment that one might use in determining what to write about. The reason we asked that question this year is because we wanted to really get to know people. We are looking at people that we're going to invite into the Tepper community, and it's a lifetime invitation. So we want to make sure that we get a sense of who the applicant is as a person, and not just the data points on the paper. And so we felt that essay question allowed us to get a little bit deeper into who the applicant is.
Great. Yeah. And I appreciate, yeah, that explanation. That's what I was trying to get at. In terms of financing now, so we have many international listeners, and so scholarships and loans are very important for them. What percentage of your class gets scholarships, and could you let us know how applicants can improve their chances of winning scholarships?
Of course. About 40% of our class has some level of scholarship. The scholarships range from $10,000 to full tuition, and the $10,000 is per academic year. So it's across 2 years, it would be a $20,000 award. But the average is $12,000 a year. To position oneself best in terms of receiving a scholarship, the things that we look at to make scholarship decisions are a little bit more narrow than we use to make admissions decisions. So we're going to look at a combination of things, including the GMAT score, past academic performance. The interview plays into that component as well. We're looking at those elements so that we're able to pull together the strongest candidates and offer scholarships to them.
And those scholarships are merit-based?
They are merit-based, yes.
Would you have any other financing tips for our listeners?
Yeah, there are a lot of opportunities to get information about financing your MBA. So take the initiative to look for outside scholarships. You would be surprised the number of scholarships that are available, and you just need to take a little bit of initiative to look for those. Also, I would say we have a financial aid office that works just with our graduate students at the Tepper School. They're a great resource for candidates, and we will often offer throughout the admission cycle financial aid webinars. So feel free to sign up for one of those. Those folks work every day in the financial aid world and can give both domestic and international students some guidance into the directions of places to look for additional financing.
Fantastic. And I'll be sure to link to that page in the show notes, as well as the student ambassador database you guys have. I think that's a great, great initiative. Now, my favorite part of the podcast is talking about careers. So, could you share what makes Tepper special from a career perspective?
We have a fantastic Career Opportunity Center who are literally industry experts who worked in their fields and have come to Tepper and now work directly with students interested in those industries. So the idea of understanding what it takes to succeed, for instance, in the financial services industry. The career counselors working with our students have been there. They've done that work. Same for marketing, for operations, their consulting. Those people have that experience. And so it's important for students to know that, because that's not necessarily the same in, you know, at every business school. So I think that, combined with the small size, again, living in 2 years in a business school that's a small community, that one-on-one time that you can spend with your career coach is just as important. And the work that the second-year students do to help the first-year students navigate the career process is really remarkable. And so the students rely on one another to help them navigate that process, in addition to the work that's done with the Career Opportunity Center. Not to mention that the Accelerate Leadership Center also plays an important role in collaborating with the Career Opportunity Center in helping to prepare students to present them best their best selves during the interviews.
It sounds like there's a lot of resources supporting career searches and self-awareness at Carnegie Mellon Tepper. It sounds like there's a ton.
There is, and one, if I may, and I'm sorry, Darren, one thing that I do want to mention, because I think this is an important thing to mention. We have three different delivery models for our MBA, but it's one degree. So if you're a full-time student, or if you're a part-time student on campus, or a part-time student in our online hybrid MBA, you have access to the same career resources regardless of which program you're applying to.
Okay, part-time, and what is your other delivery module?
We have a part-time online hybrid program that allows students to not only take classes online during the week, but every 6.5 weeks, they come together as a group. So there's in-class study with one another that's live, as well as online during the week that's also live, but it's virtual, it's remote.
This is an area of business education I'm very interested in, these sort of hybrid online programs. And maybe we can get you on a podcast again to talk about that specific offering.
Yeah, we'd love to do it.
Yeah. Could you also let us know what trends you're seeing in student placements at Tepper?
Sure. So, you know, the information that I'll share with you is from first an industry perspective and then a geography perspective. And I want to share those two things just to give you maybe a more full picture. But the top three industries where our graduates go, 33% of our grads last year went into the technology industry, 27% went into consulting, and 16% went into financial services. The remainder went into a variety of other industries, but those are the top three that I wanted to make sure to highlight. Also, from a geography standpoint, I think this is one thing that might surprise some people, especially since we're, you know, located in Pittsburgh. It's not necessarily one of the major cities in the U.S., but an awesome city, I might add. 30% of our graduates go to the West Coast, 27% to the Northeast, and then 19% to the Mid-Atlantic states. But I think it would surprise a lot of people that 30% of our students go to the West Coast.
Yeah, I mean, are those predominantly for tech sort of positions or tech companies?
They are predominantly. We have a fantastic relationship with Amazon, and we have a lot of graduates that end up there, for instance.
So for our listeners, I want to make very clear, Carnegie Mellon has an incredible reputation for being a top engineering school in the United States. Wanted to make that very clear at the undergraduate and graduate levels, you know, for some of our international listeners. And I'm guessing maybe that has an effect in terms of what companies are looking to recruit from Tepper?
Well, I think I think the reputation of the larger college university has an impact. But I think the work that our Career Opportunity Center does is not only working with the students, but they're very active in business development as well. So they are working, each of the career counselors has a set of companies they work with in their industries to do the business development work. And so certainly the reputation of Carnegie Mellon helps and supports that, but very specifically, our career team is helping potential employers understand the skills that our students bring to the workplace.
On that note, what advice do you have to your incoming first year students, you know, on the first week of orientation, in terms of how they can really succeed career-wise at Carnegie Mellon Tepper?
My biggest piece of advice is to make the career search a priority. Of course, you are coming here to get your MBA, and the skills that you will learn as a Tepper student, you know, are virtually unmatched. But the end game really is the career opportunity that lies ahead of you after the MBA program. And so the biggest piece of advice is to balance the two. Succeed academically, but also make that career search a priority and partner immediately with the Career Opportunity Center. Students have that opportunity from the very beginning during our base camp, which is an expanded orientation onboarding process. Base camp allows the students to get an overview of different business verticals from the standpoint of the academic work, as well as the career perspective and alumni perspective as well. So it's a great way for us to set the stage for the next 2 years that the students go through. And the Career Center is a big part of that onboarding experience.
I guess a related question is, how focused do you expect applicants to be with their post-MBA career plans? You know, do they need to have a couple companies in mind that they want to work for afterwards? Or can it be a more broad vision of industry and function?
It can absolutely be industry and function. A candidate would not be expected to, number one, necessarily articulate a company they want to work for, a position in the company, nor would we expect them to stick to that, right? So the reason we ask the career goals question in the essay is not that a candidate will be tied to that goal, but to demonstrate that the candidate has given thought to how they're connecting the dots between what they've done and what they want to do, and they understand how the Tepper MBA will help them to get there. It's important to come into an MBA program with a plan, because as soon as you step in the door as a student, you're going to be exposed to so many things not even considered. And it's easier to adjust an existing plan than add information to kind of just all of these ideas that are in your head. So it's kind of funny, because we all MBA program admissions offices ask for your post-MBA goals, but none of us really expect that has to be the goal that you'll attain while you're here. It's simply a starting point.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of like going to the supermarket without a list.
I mean, love that analogy.
Right, because, well, that happens to me all the time, and I get super flustered if I don't go into, you know, a supermarket with so much stuff, like, say, Carnegie Mellon, to do, and you're just kind of everywhere, all over the place. But at least if you have that starting list, you know, you'll have a much better idea, and it'll be probably a more productive couple years.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So my last question, Kelly, is there anything else about the Tepper MBA that you just wish more candidates knew about?
You know, there are two things that come to mind, and the first one is, consider the admissions team as your partners through this journey. We work in admissions for our job. That's what we do. And for applicants, it may be the first time they're applying to graduate school, and at times that can be a daunting process. And so we look at the process as a partnership, and we invite candidates to, you know, to tap into that partnership. We'd love to, you know, help you navigate the process. The second thing I would share is just remember that you do not need to already have the quantitative skills that you might initially assume you'll need to apply to Tepper. We will help you build that deep quantitative skill set. We just need you to have the motivation and the aptitude, and we'll work together from there to take it to graduation.
Thank you so much, Kelly, for your insights behind the admissions process. And I think our listeners will get a lot of value from this episode. So thank you again for being on the show.
Thank you. It's been a terrific conversation.
Thanks for listening to the Touch MBA podcast. Don't be shy. We have a mailing list. Go to touchmba.com and get yourself signed up. And we'll keep you posted with the best tips and insider interviews on how to get into your number one school. You can also find us on Twitter and Facebook at Touch MBA. See you soon.